This conference will now be recorded.
So, can you see my screen?
Yep.
Okay. So, auto-scaling. Auto-scaling is a part of automation where you automate your infrastructure to be automatically upgrade or downgrade whenever it is required, so that you don't need to worry about with high spike coming in and out. Whenever it is coming high spike, it will automatically meet the requirement and it will meet the conditions. So AWS auto-scaling monitors your application and automatically adjusts the capacity to maintain steady, predictable performance at lowest possible cost, which means it's called game day. A game day is something like if you are running our application that customer is just seeking your website for, let's say, from morning 9 a.m. to evening 6 a.m., 5 p.m. Or consider this is just a stock market. So stock market starts at 9:30 in the morning and it will last till 3:30 evening. So during those period only, you know that there will be high spike, the thousands of likes of people will be interacting to your site. So what you can do during the such time only, you can just upgrade your infrastructure with 10, 20 and number of server, whatever you want. And throughout the later of day, for let's say from 4 p.m. to early morning, another 8 or 9 a.m. What can you try and do is you can just downgrade your infrastructure with one or two servers or the minimum number of capacity you require. Because during this time, the people interacting with your website, people interacting with your application will be less comparatively. So during that period, you can save your cost. And when it will be required with a high, you know, when there will be high spike, when there will be high requirement, at the time it will meet the requirement. So you can balance your cost. It's easy to set up application scaling for multiple resources across multiple services. So what are the other benefits apart from these are scale quickly. It automatically scales. Now scaling depends on two factor. Either you can provide the bash script, like whatever the dependency you want to install, you can do it in that way, or whatever the dependency it will be required, you can just create an AMI, and with that AMI you can next time you can replicate that infrastructure. Or the third way is you just initialize an EC2 instance via auto scaling mode, and whenever you run the CI/CD tool, that is a integration tool, it will download all the packages and it will then send the code. So these are the three different ways, but AWS best practices is you should create an AMI for that, because you know when you create an AMI, you have already data which is already written in your disk, so you don't need to again download and configure all those things. It will be available. It will, you are just replicating that EC2 instance. It maintains the performance, so doesn't matter how many numbers of traffic you are getting, it always maintains your performance. It always meet the requirement whatever it will be. It has a better scaling decision, like you have a decision over when you want to scale. When your CPU utilization reaches to 70%, 80%, or there is a high network in and out bandwidth is available. So you have different scaling decisions available. You can choose at what moment based on your application, you can choose that decision. And it is one of the most cost optimizing, like we have just discussed a scenario where if you don't want to run a high infrastructure during the night time, then you can just download your infrastructure, and during the high spike only, you can just upgrade your infrastructure. So in this way, you can save your cost. Scaling component, there are three components that we will be looking into while having a lab session. First is group, that is your EC2 instances are organized in a group, which means like now consider there are three units. First is front end, back end and database. Now if there is a high spike at the front end side, then front end only should upgrade their infrastructure. We should not upgrade the infrastructure from the back end side. If there is a high spike, there is a high requirement at the front end side, so we need to improve our front end. So we will create a group with all the front end server. For example, let's say there are two EC2 instances for front end, two EC2 instances for back end, and two EC2 instances for database. Now, whatever the high spike is coming, if it is reaching directly to your front end, then it means that your front end will be having a high traffic. So what we will do, we'll create a group with two EC2 instance group of front end, so that if the utilization reaches to 80%, then whatever the next EC2 will come, that will be a part of again front end. So here we need to tell the Amazon is auto scaling configuration that what you need to upgrade. So we will create a group with all the front end. If there is a high spike again occurring at the back end, so we will create one more group at the back end, so that if when it reaches to 70% or 80%, it will then create one more EC2 instance at the back end side. So in this way, you will have a separate, completely isolated area what part you want to upgrade. Otherwise, what will happen if you want to upgrade a front end side, it will also create one EC2 instance at back end. So to have a segregated area, you can create a multiple groups and you can just define at what moment you want to scale up and etc. So we have a group. Then we have a launch config. A launch config is nothing but a template where we define all the parameters about the EC2 instance, like which AMI should it create, which security group should it attach, and the key pairs, instance type, which instance type, how many volume of storage. So whatever we do while creating an EC2 instance, whatever the configuration we do, the same thing we will do, we will tell this in the launch config, that whatever the new EC2 instance is coming, you should have this kind of information, you should attach this kind of resources to it. And the third is the scaling plan. A scaling plan is nothing but a plan where you define on which criteria, on which circumstances it should upgrade or downgrade. Like if my EC2 instance reaches to 70%, then you should create a one more. So such kind of scaling plans available. Auto scaling group. So consider this is your currently infrastructure with you are running with a current one EC2 instance. Your infrastructure is suitable with one EC2 instance. This is your minimum size. And in the auto scaling mode, you have defined that your desired capacity should be 2, which means there will be always 2 EC2 instances running for you during the normal period. And this is a maximum capacity that you have defined, that if any high spike occurs, then it should extend to up to 5 EC2 instances. So what will happen? There will be always 2 EC2 instances running. One, that is a part of EC2. Second, that the second EC2 will be always part of your auto scaling. Now the rest of the 3 EC2 will be created whenever these 2 EC2 instances reaches to 70%. So this becomes your scale out capacity. Every time you will have 2 EC2 instances running. But if these 2 EC2 instances reaches to 70%, then it will create a third EC2 instance. If this 3 EC2 instance reaches to 70%, that will create a fourth EC2 instance. And if all the 4 EC2 instances reaches to 70%, that will go to 50 EC2 instances. Now, in any case, you are getting high spike again, more and more high spikes you are getting, and all these 5 EC2 instances reaches to 100%. That is, these servers cannot handle more than request now, then your entire infrastructure will go down. Because the maximum capacity you have defined is 5. So it will grow till 5 EC2 instances. It will not go beyond that. So you need to always define your minimum capacity and the maximum capacity. The reason why you need to define your maximum capacity is if any kind of attack is happened, like DDoS attack or anything. So at that time you have complete control till when you want to upgrade your infrastructure. Otherwise it will grow till 20, 25, 30, depending upon your plans. Okay. Any question in doubt here in auto scaling part?
No.
Okay. So scaling option, we have three kind of scaling options. One is manual scaling, like whenever it reaches to 70%, you will get a notification. You can trigger a notification and then you manually create one more EC2 instance and do all the stuff. This is manual scaling. Second is schedule scaling, like whenever it is required, you can just schedule it. And third one is dynamic scaling that we have just seen. Whenever it reaches to 70%, 80%, so depending upon the requirement, it will automatically grow and shrink. So this is all about auto scaling. So in the last lecture, we have created two EC2 servers, server 1 and server 2. I have terminated the server 2. We don't require that. And this is server 1 in which I have just installed just Apache server. And if I just copy this IP address and open, it says, hi, this is web server 1. That's it. So now what we will do, and we also have load balancer. So let me just give you an overview about what is load balancer, or let me just quickly create one more load balancer. So while creating a load balancer, you can just click on create load balancer and choose what kind of load balancer you want, application based, network based, or classic, that is previous generation. We'll go with again application, and I can say your ELP. And we will go again with internet facing, because these are we are getting a request from the internet, so we will choose the internet one. And we'll need to select both the EC2 instance here. Next, go with the Linux security group, and here I will create a target group. Now, based on this target group, whenever your new EC2 instance will come up, for example, you have two EC2 instances running, and in the auto scaling mode, it has created one more EC2 instance. Now, whenever your third EC2 instance will come, that becomes a part of this target group, which means that EC2 instance will be entered into your load balancer. So whatever the incoming connection is coming from the load balancer will now have an equal distribution between these three EC2 instances. So this is always remember, this is very important to remember that whenever in auto scaling mode, whenever a new EC2 instance is coming, you should divert it to your load balancer target group. A load balancer target group is a group that defines your logical unit at the front end, back end, or whatever your group is. So you will name as auto scaling target. And the instance health checking will go with 2, 3, 5 register targets. We have only one register, review and create. So currently the state is a provisioning, and this is your DNS. So what you need to do, once you have this DNS ready, now you can map this DNS with your domain. For example, if you have purchased abcd.com, then you can just map that domain with this DNS endpoint. So whenever that abcd.com will be hitted on the browser, that will be reverted to this DNS that is mapped with this DNS. So still in the provisioning. And in the target group, you can see what are your EC2 instances, and currently the status is initial. Now we have done here a small threshold, like we didn't have any given any kind of path here, like index.html or any kind of application endpoint. So it will just check for the browser whether that application is running or not. Once it is checked, it will be marked as healthy. If the document is present, if the web server is running, then it will mark as healthy. Otherwise, it will be considered as unhealthy. So it will take few seconds.
I have a question.
Yeah,
so you showed me like this load balancer is for internet base, right? So how the internal load balancer work? Is it like you need to separately?
No, just load balancer are same. The concept of the load balancer is same. There are two terms, internal facing or internet facing. Internet facing something when a user is sending a request from the internet, like we go on the amazon.com site. So whenever we hit on amazon.com, that becomes an internet facing request. And when your front end makes a request to your back end, then that becomes a part of your internal load balancer. Just a second, I'll just show you a diagram that will be helpful for you. So the current status becomes healthy. And if I just hit to the DNS of that ELB, AS ELB endpoint, it should trigger to this is web server one. So now this ELB is sending request to my EC2 instance, and if that EC2 instance is healthy, then it will send a request here. Now, if I have 5 EC2 instances running, then it will sequence by send to each of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So here I'll just show you one diagram that will be helpful to you, like for understanding what is internet facing and what is internal facing. Okay, can you see this diagram?
Yeah.
So this is internet. Whatever the application requests are coming, these are coming from the internet. Okay, incoming application traffic. Like let's consider an example of Amazon.com. Okay, whatever you see on Amazon.com, the graphics and all the labels and all the things, that is situated in the public subnet EC2 instance here. Okay, this is front end, and this is a back end where all the banking and address detail processing of the order is done in the private subnets, that is in the your private EC2 instance. And in the database, a record has been maintained. So this is a three-tier architecture something. Now, whenever an application is requesting for a, like say you have requested Amazon.com, you have just entered in the browser Amazon.com, that application request sent to the Route 53. So this is a part of a Route 53. What Route 53 does is it sends the traffic to your ELB. Now, when request is coming directly from the internet and hitting to the ELB, this kind of ELB becomes internet facing, because we have opened a port for an internet to get the request from the internet. So this kind of ELB becomes internet facing. Now this request will be sent to each of them EC2 instance, one in public subnet 1A, one in this subnet, one in this subnet, and again in this subnet. Now suppose there are 5 participants, there are 5 users who have wished to buy a product. Now this request has been used and forwarded to this internet facing ELB. This internet facing ELB will send the traffic, will send this 5 requests to this EC2 instance one by one. Now whatever the data that this server will show, based on that, the now the users are now try to go to the add to cart and buy to option. And then this request will be sent via this endpoint to this ELB. For example, this 5 request has been sent, has been viewed here, and then it is sent here for processing of this 5 add to cart or buying option. Now this ELB will send a traffic to these 2 private EC2 instance for payment details, for address detail, and for creating an order. Now, sending of traffic from public EC2 instance to private EC2 instance and hitting to a ELB, this kind of ELB becomes a internal ELB, where we are not exposing any internet. Here, this ELB is not exposed to any kind of internet service. This ELB is exposed to have access to get a request only from this EC2 instance and this EC2 instance. So this this ELB is only be suitable for getting a request from these 2 EC2 instances only. So that's what it make it internal load balancer. Similarly here, whatever the order that it will process here will be recorded in the database on this ELB via this ELB. So this ELB becomes a part of a internal facing. Whenever a request is coming from the internet, that becomes an internet facing, and whatever the when we are not exposing anything on the internet, that becomes a part of an internet. Okay, Neeraj? Yeah. Or do you want me to repeat?
No, got it. Thanks.
Okay. In the recorded session, you will get all these things. No need. So we have one load balancer, one target group, and one EC2 instance running. So we will just go in the launch configuration, that is a part of our auto scaling. In the auto scaling, the first thing is launch config, and second is auto scaling group. So first of all, we will create a launch config. That is, we will tell Amazon to while creating an EC2 instance, what are the configuration that you need to do. We'll tell all this information. So create a launch config. And again, the same thing. Now, very important, you can just select an AMI and EC2 instance, again, what kind of EC2 instance you require. And here you can just configure what are the users data that you want to install. Like you want to install Apache server with Java or PHP, MySQL, whatever the thing that you want to do, you can just write a bash script here. So this is the one way. Or you can do create a launch config and choose an AMI. For example, this AMI I have created. Now this AMI contains an Apache server and a small index.html file. So for example, now you have created an AMI with Apache server, Java install, PHP, Python, everything installed, whatever the dependency you require to run your application. So you can just create such kind of AMI and you can select here directly. So you don't need to again have a internet connection to download all these things, to have a configuration, all this, because it will take at least few seconds, 30 seconds, 1 minute, depending upon the what kind of application you are installing, it will take a certain amount of time. So when you go with this kind of AMI part, it becomes easy, without downloading anything, without configuring anything, you will have complete data in your application. So this is one way and this is another way. Okay, go. We'll go with this one again. Yes, I want to continue. Next. You can select what kind of EC2 instance type you want. Let's go with the T2 micro again, free tier eligible. Next. And here we can just provide here a name, auto scaling group. And if you want to attach any EC2 instance role, IAM role, then you can attach. If you want to enable CloudWatch detail monitoring, now you get a basic monitoring with all the AWS services. But if you go with enabling of this detail monitoring, it will charge you. Detail monitoring is something like you will get a response from the whatever the logs it being created, and you have complete control for every 1 minute. So whatever, for example, if an EC2 instance you have just created right now, whatever the logs you have created, what are the CPU utilization you have made, you will get a response for every single minute here. And with the basic one, what we get as a default, you get at an interval of 5 minutes. So that is the difference only. In the advanced setting, you can define what kind of things that you want to install. Let's create pin bash yum install httpd -y, that is Apache server we are downloading. Then we are running at the Apache server service httpd start chk config httpd on. So chk config httpd on, what it will do in any case, like your EC2 instance has been restarted or you have just rebooted your EC2 instance, then in such case, what will happen? Your EC2, whatever the application you are running, that will be stopped. Similar to our host computer. If you are running Word, Microsoft, Excel, Mail, whatever the service in your, you know, host computer, and if you just click on restart, so whatever the application you are currently running, that all will be terminated, that all will be stopped, and a new session you need to create. In a similar way, whenever we restart the machine, all the application running will be stopped and your EC2 instance get restarted. So with this configuration, chk config http on, what it will do, whenever your server restarts, it will automatically start the Apache server. It's like you are adding into auto logging feature. Then we'll create a file. Let's call this is made under auto scaling mode, and I will write this file in /where www/html/index. So Neeraj, do you know what is this part where www.html?
Yeah, so this is basically exposing to the internet, right?
Yeah, this is your public folder. Whenever you install any kind of server, application server, you get one folder where you can dump all these files, all your website, so that it will be visible on the internet. So whatever the data you will dump here, that will be able to show on the internet. Okay, so these are my basic configuration, and let's just hit add storage. We'll go with the default 8 GB of storage. Then configure security group. I can create one more security group, auto scaling security group, and HTTP anywhere. Review and create launch config. Select what kind of pair you want. Right, create launch config. So once it is created, you have direct option to create an auto scaling group via this launch config. You can just hit on here, create, and give a name. Let's call AS group. Start with number of EC2 instances. Like, what is your minimum size? Let's go with the one. Network, we will go with the default one. We haven't seen this feature yet. So now this is something very important. Load balancer. Do you want to receive traffic for one or more load balancer? Yes. Every time, whatever you create an EC2 instance, whatever you do on the auto scaling, do you must add in the load balancer. If you miss this point, then what will happen? You have created two EC2 instances, and in the auto scaling mode, if third EC2 instance is coming and you didn't add any information here, then few more EC2 instances will be automatically created. But whatever the requests are coming, that will not be sent to the these newly created EC2 instances. I mean to say, you have two EC2 instances running, and if this EC2 instance reaches at 80% of CPU utilization, and based on the configuration that it will create a now new EC2 instance, third one. Now, if you miss this point, that target group or classic load balancer thing, adding this EC2 instance to load balancer, then what will happen? This newly created EC2 instance will not be a part of that load balancer. So what will happen? Whatever the incoming connection is coming at the ELB side, that will be sent again to the first two EC2 instances. It will not go to third EC2 instance, because this third EC2 instance is not registered with that ELB. So this is very important. Whenever you create auto scaling group, you need to add to a load balancer. And if you have a classic load balancer, then you can just directly click on here and select the load balancer. But if you don't have load classic load balancer, if you are using application load balancer or network load balancer, what you can do, you can just click on here and select the target group. The target group that we have created is the load balancer. So AS target. Now health check type EC2 instance we want to do on EC2, etc. Then next, configure scaling policy and use the scaling policy to adjust capacity. Now scale between 0 to n number of instances that you can define here. Let's go with 5 EC2 instances. This is your minimum maximum capacity. Scale group size. Now, on which metric do you want to do? Application load balancer, request per count target, which means like if you are having a 5 EC2 instance or 10 EC2 instance, 5,000 or 10,000 requests are coming to this particular load balancer, then it should create a new EC2 instance or what kind of thing. Second is average CPU utilization. If it reaches 70%, 80%, then it should. If you are dealing with any network kind of applications, then you have average network in and out. So if number of network goes in or out, you can just create a kind of thing. Let's go with the CPU utilization, and here you can mention this number. Now this is very important to consider a number. For example, like you are running a Java-based application. Now whenever new instance comes, it requires certain amount of time to install all the packages, to download all the packages, install the package, and to deploy then code and start the service. Now, whatever the amount of time it will require to do all this process, you need to understand that, and based on that, you need to select this target. If it requires very long time, let's say it requires 2 to 3 minutes or 5 minutes, then you should consider it at 60%. Whenever it reaches to 60%, it will create one more EC2 instance, and then it will take few more times to, you know, to make this new EC2 instance comes up. And during the time, this EC2 will reach to 70%, 80%, 90% based on the application required. So you have a small amount of time so that you have a new EC2 instance to come up. So you need to maintain this target value based on how long it will take to your EC2 instance to come up. So you need to, based on that only value, you need to select here. Then configure notification. Now you can also create a notification like if it when you request when you get a request from launch configuration, terminate, fail to launch, or fail to commit. So any kind of thing is happened in the autoscaling mode, it has automatically created a new EC2 instance, or it has automatically terminated that EC2 instance, newly created EC2 instance. So you will get a notification. If any kind of fail is occurred while configuration or termination of an EC2 instance, then also you will get a notification. Now, how notification is get, that is a part of SNS, and we haven't seen SNS yet. So we will just skip this part. And then configure tags. Like you can configure tags here. You can say this is a part of auto scaling. Review everything. And so here you can see start with, let's call with 0 EC2 instance. Next. So our minimum size is 0, so it will not create any kind of EC2 instance as of now, and maximum it will grow till 5. Then create auto scaling group. Policy. Metric min. Okay, our group has been successfully created. Now our EC2 instance size is 0, desired is 0, minimum is 0, maximum is 5. So it should not create any kind of EC2 instance as of now. If you see in the EC2 instance part, you will have only one EC2 instance running. But if I just stop this EC2 instance or terminate this EC2 instance, it will now create few more EC2 instances. Let me just terminate this part. And as soon as the Elastic load balancer detect that it has one unhealthy EC2 instance, it will automatically send a request to auto scaling, and that auto scaling will automatically create an EC2 instance. We need to wait for a certain time. So as our desires is 0, so I don't think so it will create a, as a, any EC2 instance right now. So what we can do is edit, and we can say desire is 1 and save. Now it will automatically start creating a new EC2 instance. Basically, how EC2 instance sends the things to ELP that I have 0 EC2 instance, and that ELP will send traffic to auto scaling that it has 0 EC2 instance based on the logs, based on the CloudWatch logs. So as soon as the CloudWatch detects, it will start creating a new EC2 instance. So it has automatically started the new EC2 instance to come up. That is in auto scaling mode. It has created one key pair. Now every configuration will be the same. The key pair, the Amazon AMI, the auto scaling security group, and everything. T2 micro EC2 instance. Whatever the launch config you will enter, it will end, it will have the same part of thing. So let me just open this website. It will take few seconds. Okay, this is made under auto scaling mode. Now if I try to hit the same part on the load balancer, if this is a part of load balancer, if we whatever the thing that we have done, if it is successful, then whatever the DNS when we hit, we will get the same response. Again, still showing this is web server one. Now this is made under auto scaling mode. So in this way, you can make ELB to be a part of a newly created auto scaling mode, auto scaling, and you can create an infrastructure with EC2, with load balancer and auto scaling mode. Together, all three will be a part of completely high availability, fault tolerant infrastructure. Okay, any question in doubt?
Nope.
Neil, do you want to try it right now, the EC2 one?
Oh, probably I'll try offline.
Okay, fine. So this is all about the EC2, ELB, and auto scaling. So now we will move to our next topic, that is VPC. So today we will just see an overview about what is the basic of internet and what are the things that you will require to understand before going to a VPC part, because VPC is completely networking part, so you need to have a little information about the networking. First is IP. So IP is internet protocol, which has two versions. First is IP version 4 and IP version 6. Currently, as of now, we are dealing only with the IP version 4, which is 32 bit long. It looks like this. And IP version 6 is 128 bit long, which we are not currently using. Some of the scientists and research purpose, we are just using the IP version 6, because currently, as of now, our system, our population is enough to have IP version 4 only. So we are dealing with the IP version 4. But nowadays, people are start using the IP version 6 as number of internet users are increasing day by day. So we need to somewhere move to IP version 6 in the future. So these are the two versions, IP version 4 and IP version 6. IP version 4 is 32 bit long, and IP version 6 is 128 bit long. IP version 4, it has, let's say, 2.255.0.38. Now every single bit starts from 0 and ends with 255. That is, each bit has a capacity of 256 bits, 0 to 255. Okay. Now, whenever we say my IP address is 2.0.255.38, so this is something like we can understand. But the language in which computer understand and in which network works is a hexadecimal format. So whatever we say that 0.2.0.38, it is then converted into hexadecimal form. So 2.255, so 2 is represented as 0100000. How it is created? Do you have any idea, guys, how hexadecimal works? Hello.
Yeah, we studied, like I studied long back. I don't exactly remember how the conversion does, but we did study in a bachelor's.
Yeah, yeah. I'll just show you how it works, a small demo.
Yeah.
So basically, our each bit is 8 digit long. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 into 4, that is 32 bit. Okay. So when we talk about the 32, so 00000. So these are 8-bit long. So this is represented as 0. How to represent 1 is 00000001, which is represented as 1. If you want to represent 2, 10 will be represented as 2. 3 will be represented as 11. Means all this part will be a par 00 again. From starting 6 digit will be a 00, and this will be considered as 3. Now to represent 4, you will have 10100, then 01010110, again 0111. Once it is done, 10001 10010 right 1011 then 1100. So in this way all this goes. So once it is all it reaches to 1111, then again the sixth digit will start 01000, then all the combination has been made. So from 0000 till 111111, that becomes 255. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so these are the configuration. This is the way how our decimal number is translated to hexadecimal. So this is 4, this is 5, this is 6, this is 7. So this, in this way, it gets translated from decimal to hexadecimal. So the reason why we need to look into this is, so this becomes 255, becomes all 1 becomes 255, 0 becomes 0, and to represent 32, it represents like this 00100110. Okay, now let's take a scenario. This is my IP range. This is my range of a VPC. Now, whenever you are dealing with your organization IP address, or when you are dealing with your private virtual cloud, you need to define in such a way 10.0.0.0/16, something /16. A /16 define how many IP addresses you want to reserve for your organization. Whatever the company you are working on, it has, it's also a separate range of IP addresses. Your private IP address you have reserved for that. You can reserve this kind of thing via this /16 or /28. Now this /16/28 define how many IP addresses you want to reserve. Now when I say 10.0.0.0/16, it will be look like this: 10.0.0.16. Now every 8 digit, every 8 bit is a part of a single digit. Starting 8 bit becomes 1 digit, again another 8 bits become 1 digit similarly. So 8 plus 8 plus 8 plus 8, that is 32 bit long. When I say 16, it starts from the right hand side, and starting 16 bits has been reserved, which means this starting 16 bits becomes dynamic. You can change it, but the first A16 becomes constant, so you cannot change this part. Okay, this orange part becomes constant and this green part becomes dynamic, which means when I say my IP, my organization requires an IP address of 10.0.0.0/16, so what will happen, I will get a now IP address for whenever I go to my office and connect to internet, I will get a IP address starting with 10.0. So 10.0 will be always constant with all the IP addresses in my organization. Now next 0.0 will be keep changing. Someone will get 1.0, someone get 2.0, someone get 30, 40, 04, 01, anything. So when you say /16, first two digit becomes constant and the next two digit becomes dynamic. Now, /16 is the maximum number of IP addresses you can allocate in AWS. With /16, it will start from 00 to 255. So 0 to 255, 0 to 255. The maximum probability you will get is 65,536 different IP addresses, like 10.0.0.0, 10.0.0.1, 10.0.0.2, 3, 4. Again, then 10.0, 1.0, 1.1, 1.2, again 2.0, 2.3. So these are the number of possibilities that you can create. So maximum you can create with VPC is /16, which will give you 65,536 IP addresses. This is the range 10.0.0.0 to 10.0.255.255. This is the maximum amount of capacity you can reserve. So did you get this point? This is very important. When we start the VPC part, this is very important to think, look into.
Yep.
Yep. Neeraj, are you good with this?
Yeah, I got it. I mean, we did a lot of in-house engineering, but
yeah. We have already all these things done in the engineering part. So that's why it becomes very difficult when we could just come up right now and having all these things. So I just had a small, a basic part in the networking. So what we have, what we'll be looking into in the future. So we can just have a small recap on it.
Sure.
Let's take one more example. 10.0.0.24. So when we say 24, 8 plus 8 plus 8 becomes constant, and the rest of this 8 digit becomes dynamic. So your IP address is now restricted with 10.0.0, and you can have an IP addresses from last bit 0 to 255. So your IP address will get maximum of 255 IP addresses you can allocate for your infrastructure. Also, you can do /18. /17, /18, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, until 28. Now, when I say, let me just show you. So till 16, that is the maximum number of capacity you can reserve for AWS. This part becomes constant and this part becomes dynamic. Okay. When you say 17, then 17, 18. Okay. For 17, this much part becomes constant. And you will get a IP address starting from this range till this. When you say 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. You have a complete control on defining what number of IP address you want. So when I say /16, you will get 65,536 IP address. When I say 17, you will get a less number of IP addresses. Like the combination will be less. When you say 16, again, your combination of having a maximum number of IP addresses become less. So you need to think about it, how many IP addresses you want to allocate in your AWS infrastructure. Based on that, you should select a VPC range. This is called something VPC CIDR. Okay. This becomes 19, 20, 21, 22, 24, 25, 26, 27, and 28. So this is a maximum, this is a list you can go with it. Beyond this 28, you cannot reserve this. Reason is, whenever you create a subnet or a VPC in AWS, whatever the IP address you will allocate, AWS reserve 5 IP addresses in every subnet for its internal purpose. The first starting four IP addresses and the last IP address, which means like whenever you will create a VPC range with let's say 10.0.0.24. So the starting four IP addresses, that is 0.0, 0.1, 0.2, and 0.3. These four IP addresses will be reserved for Amazon, and the last bit, that is 0.255. So these five IP addresses will be reserved for Amazon for its internal use. This is very important. From exam point of view, if you are looking for exam certification, then this kind of question is asked in exam before. So you need to know that for every VPC you create, AWS reserve 5 IP addresses. First 4 IP addresses and the last 5th and the last IP addresses. Okay. So when you say /28, you get only 16 IP addresses. Then after the 16 IP addresses, Amazon Reserve 5 IP addresses. So totally, in actual, you will get only 11 IP addresses. That's why this is a max. This is a least number of IP addresses you can collect with slash 20. We have all this part in the slides. We have. So you have 0 to 255, and the range is here. One more example with slash 28. You have only 4 digits for changing. 0000 to 00111. Only you get 16 IP addresses, and out of that, 5 IP addresses will be now reserved for the AWS for its internal purpose for registering our VPC and all this thing, and you will get only 11 IP addresses. So is it fine here? The basics of networking, like whatever will require in the for moving ahead in the VPC part. This is a basic that you need to understand. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Amazon Virtual Private Cloud. AWS VPC enables you to launch AWS resources in virtual network that you have defined. That virtual network, which means the IP addresses that we have just seen, 0.10.0016. This is something that is virtual network that you have defined. Based on this network, you will get your own private cloud. Now, this is not important that if somebody has already used 10.0.0.0/16, that you cannot use. You can also create your own 10.0.0.16. It doesn't matter if somebody else is using the same IP address. It doesn't matter. Even in your own AWS account, you can create number of VPC with the same CIDR range. Like you can create one VPC with 10.0.0.16, also another VPC with same VPC range 10.0.0.16. That is also possible and that is also acceptable. This virtual network closely resembles a traditional network that you have operated in your own data center. So the concept is similar. Whatever you do on your traditional or physical infrastructure, the same thing you can create in the virtual. Now, these are the certain points that is very important. VPC reserves the range of private IP address for your resources. So whatever the resources you will create, that becomes a part of a private IP address. Let me just show you one demo. If I go back to my EC2 instance, I have one public IP and one is private IP. Can anyone of you tell me what is public IP?
Accessible on the internet or?
Yeah, that is accessible only on the internet. And another fact is it keep changing. If you restart this EC2 instance, it will automatically change. It is not the static one, it is dynamic. Whereas the another IP address, that is private IPs, this is something that will always stick to your EC2 instance until you terminate this EC2 instance. So this is something that is private IP address that you will create in your VPC. Now 172.31, this is something that you will find in all the regions whenever you go.
Hello, Lalit, we are unable to hear you.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yep.
Okay. Sorry, some kind of outage was came at the GoTo meeting side and automatically stopped audio. Okay. So I was talking about the VPC reserve the range of private IP address for you. Now here, this is public IP that will automatically keep changing, but this is private IP that will always stick to your IP address. Now, if you go in any of this region, Mumbai, North Virginia, Singapore, etc., you will always have one default VPC in your AWS account in your every single region. If you go to these VPCs, that is default VPC, you will get this kind of IP address. Let me just show you. So this is the default one. You will not get the same name here. You will not get any kind of name here. This is something that I have written here default, and you will get this kind of name here. That is 172.31.0.0.60. This is the default IP address that Amazon is working for its default VPC part. So based on this, you will get your private IP address for your resources 172.31.16. So my IP address of this instance is also 170.36, and this is randomly changing IP addresses. Okay, so this is something that whenever you create an IP addresses, you get an one pre-install or a pre-activated one IP address reserved for your resources. VPCs are region specific. Again, whatever the infrastructure you will design, you need to first choose a region where you want to create an infrastructure. Mumbai, North India, based on the where your client is located, you need to choose. Now, sometimes what will happen, you have a client in multiple location. You have in US, UK, Australia, Singapore. So in that case, you can create either a multi-regional infrastructure. If your application is too big, then you can create a multi-regional application or multi-regional infrastructure. Or if your region is, if your infrastructure is small, then what you can do, you can choose a region which is nearest to all of this. For example, like if India, from India to US, if it is like sending a request and coming back is just 400 milliseconds. If the same is with the UK, let's say 300 milliseconds. With Australia, it's say 450 milliseconds. And with Singapore, it says 200 milliseconds. So you can choose a region, India, so that it will send a distributed traffic to all these different regions. So you can choose these two kinds of mode, either a multi-regional model or a region which is close, equally close to all of the other region. Then the default limit of maximum VPC per region is 5. Basically, whatever the plan that you have choose while creating your AWS account is the basic one. So with the basic plan, you will get only 5 maximum VPC that you can create in every single region. Now, you if you want to extend more than this limit, then you can just raise a support ticket to AWS, and these people will raise your limit 5, 10, but you need to consume at least 4 VPC. Based if you have consumed 4 VPC out of your region, then only they will increase the limit. Okay, so you can increase the limit by raising a support ticket anytime, but this is something that you need to remember, that the default limit is 5. Then 2 VPCs can have an overlapping IP address, which means if a single VPC has a range of 10.0.0.16, same another VPC can also have a range of 10.0.0.16. It doesn't matter that it is conflicting or any kind of thing. You can have an overlapping IP address. Traffic to the VPC is being maintained by the routable. Now in our organization or in our home, if you have a landline connection, then you will also have a router. A router is something that internet is coming via router, and this router will now distribute the traffic to your mobile application, to your mobile devices, laptops, and other devices. With the same router, you have complete control. If you want to block any particular site, or if you want to, you know, any kind of block you want to do, whatever the configuration you want to do, you will do on the router side. So router is something that will, you know, distribute the traffic in your organization. So in a similar way, we have the same route table. A route table is something similar to that router, where you will define all the rules, how and when your data should be routed. We will look into route table in much detail in the few next slides. Then we have two kinds of securities in the VPC. First is security group and second is NACL. Security group we have already seen, that is only related to your EC2 instance. You can attach and security group to EC2 instance, to an RDS instance, to other different kind of AWS resources also. So this is one security group from security perspective. And the second is the NACL, that is Network Access Control List. Network Access Control List. Now NACL is something like an administrative blockage. For example, if you are a team leader, and then you can block a certain level of restriction at the subnet level. Basically, whatever we create an EC2 instance, we create inside a particular VPC, we create inside a particular subnet. Now, if you want to restrict something at the multiple EC2s, if you want to restrict HTTP request to multiple EC2 instance, then you can add such kind of rule in the NACL. Now, one of the best feature of the NACL is, like, for example, you are running an application and some hacker has hacked your system, and you are dealing with any kind of financial project. So you are incurring a lot of loss in that. So what you can do in such case, you can just create a NACL rule and define the block this port. For example, whatever the financial things that you are using, financial transaction that you are using, that is on the port, let's say 3389. Now, in such case, if someone is hacked your system and trying to exploit all this financial things and all, if you are money dealing with any kind of thing, if it is doing such kind of thing, what you can do, you can just create a NACL rule and block that port. Of course, that blockage will drop the connection with your hacker, but it will also block the connection between your customers also. During that time, your customers will also not be able to connect to your application. But this is something that you can do in the disaster's time. If somebody has hacked your system and you are unable to find what is the exactly bug, in such case, what you can do, you can use this NACL. There is one company in the Mumbai which has done the same thing. Basically, if you remember, in the past, we have one ransomware attack. So that company was dealing with the database that was storing a large number of database of user database across the world. They have clients from everywhere. So the company was dealing with database. They were just storing the database. And due to this ransomware attack, their data was completely, day by day, by the time it goes, it was completely lost. Every single minute, they are losing some kind of data. So what they have done, until they figure out, they have just closed entire NACL connection. They have closed entire every TCP connection, starting from 0 to 65,000 ports. They have denied all these ports. So that something that has cost, saved their cost a lot from dealing with their losses, from dealing with their customers' data and everything. So NACL plays a very important role when it comes to handle multiple things. It is similar to providing permission and revoking the permission at the group level. You have 5 users in a group. Whatever the permission you will apply on the group level, that will be applicable to the user and the group members. In a similar way, if you have 5 EC2 instance, then you can just add a permission, revoke a permission at the NACL. The concept is same. You can, it's like administrative access kind of, you can say, where whatever the permission you attach or you deny, that will be applicable to all the EC2 instances made under that particular subnet. Okay, did you get this NACL part? This is very important for disaster, for troubleshooting kind of thing. Hello, Neeraj. Siri, you there?
Yeah, got it.
Yeah, good. Okay. I'm good.
So rest of the part we will look at tomorrow. We have all the part how to create a VPC, how to distribute that VPC into multiple groups, subnets, route tables, internet, etc. So we will continue it tomorrow. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. So I will share this recording soon.
Okay. Thanks, Doctor.
Okay. See you tomorrow. Bye bye.